Praise to the Lord, the Almighty. You'll find it in the hymn books in your pews.
Let us pray to our God. Father, tonight we come before you to worship you and to praise you. You sent to us your Son, Jesus, to give us the life and to live as his disciples. We are grateful for that name, Father, the name of Jesus. Lead us in your Spirit, so we will give you all the honor and honor due to your name tonight. Guide us to repent of the ways in which we fail to be one with Jesus. And revive in us the zeal to love you more and to love one another. We thank you for the graduating seniors of Gordon-Conwell Theological Seminary. You brought them here as students. Now they leave as friends. Bless them. Bless their families. Bless their friends. Bless their nations. And may you be greatly magnified as we worship you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please be seated. As I told the graduates just about 15 or 20 minutes ago, this is one of the most depressing weeks of my life. To see these people we've gotten to know for the past years and then to bid them adieu. We do hope they'll stay in touch, and I do hope also, graduates, that you'll take some time to find one or two of those faculty members that you've especially appreciated and take them aside and tell them thank you. Because the foundation of the Christian life is one of gratitude, so you have an opportunity to practice that on your way out. I also noticed that our graduations here have been a movable feast. When I first came to Gordon-Conwell Seminary just 3.5 years ago, the first graduation was over in the Bennett Center. And then with COVID, we did it online, looking at a camera and a lot of plastic. And then the next year, it was outside. And now we're in here in the chapel. So we just kind of keep moving around, but we praise God wherever we go. And we're invited to see this as a worship service, as a time of praising God on our way out before commencement tomorrow. So congratulations and welcome family members and friends and people who've supported, maybe financially, to make it possible. And if they still have some debt, feel free to help them out some more. God bless you and welcome.
It is my privilege to introduce the student speakers for tonight's service. I will be introducing all the student speakers, and then each will come up in that order. Our first speaker is Grace Eun-Sun Lee from the Hamilton campus. Grace is a graduate of the Master of Divinity program with a focus on world missions. During her time at the Hamilton campus, she has been known as the mustard seed girl, the pineapple girl, or the girl from the Philippines. These themes have been recurring in her work and participation in worship, chapel, lectures, publications, as well as student-led programs. When Grace first arrived at Gordon-Conwell back in 2018, she arrived with a desire to become a missionary wherever God calls her. She now graduates with the confidence in knowing she is already living the missional life, commissioned as God's chosen worshiper for the nations. Next is Colin Ian Dixon from the Doctor of Ministry program. Colin is from the Nagadee, Northern Ireland. He is an ordained minister in the Presbyterian Church in Ireland. He just completed 6 years of service with his wife, Marjorie, as missionaries in the Middle East. He's now serving as the associate minister in West Presbyterian Church, Bangor, Northern Ireland, where he is responsible for preaching, pastoral care, local and global mission. Next is Nubia Esperanza Suarez Avila from the Boston campus. Nubia grew up in a Catholic environment in Tuta, Boyaca, Colombia. Her parents had 4 children, and she is the 3rd child and the 1st one saved. When she finished high school, she moved to Tunja, Boyaca, Colombia, where she pursued a Bachelor of Arts degree in foreign languages in the Pedagogical and Technological University of Colombia. After graduation, she worked as a teacher in several schools in Colombia. In 2016, she went to Gordon College, where she pursued a master's in education. Currently, she's serving at the Baptist Congregation, a Congregation Family Connection Church in Natick. She is a teacher of the kids ministry, a member of the dance ministry, and a member of the intercessor prayer group at the church. Her immediate plans after graduation are to start the MDiv program at CUME and be a missionary or be involved in missions and serve in a global church. Gildardo Suarez Zamora from the Latino Global Ministries. Gildardo was baptized 24 years ago. He was sent as a missionary pastor in 2010 from the Apostolic Assembly of the Faith in Christ Jesus to the city of El Rosario, Sinaloa, Mexico. He has been in pastoral ministry for 12 years and has served in various ministries throughout his time. Last November, Gildardo was elected as Bishop Secretary of Christian Education at the national level in Mexico. Godardo plans to continue to expand Bible school education so that the parishioners can continue to be prepared. His short-term plan is to continue with his studies at the doctorate level and continue contributing to the work of the Lord. Grateful Ojurerio Lua Itiowe. Grateful is a lifelong learner. She was born in Nigeria to parents who are kingdom ambassadors. She has carried the torch as the founder of the Great Innovators Foundations for Transformation, GIFT, a nonprofit that partners with donors to train and set up small-scale businesses for the needy in Nigeria. She has served as a leader in different capacities in organizations like the Old Path Revival Church, the Lausanne Movement's Younger Leaders Team, and Good Hope Stars Schools. Grateful worked on faculty with the University of Nigeria. Grateful is a lawyer and also has an MBA in law and management from the UK. At Gordon-Conwell, she served as the African Students Ambassador and the Resident Life Coordinator for the ladies dorm, among other duties. She is graduating with a Master of Arts in Global Leadership and desires to serve the Lord in an organization that would optimize her multifaceted skills post-graduation. Fun fact is that this is her fourth higher education graduation, with three of them on different continents. Let's welcome our speakers.
Four years ago, I had just arrived from Asia. I was extremely jet-lagged. I did not know what to expect. I traveled all around the world, but Massachusetts was unfamiliar ground. Completely uprooting myself, entering new territory to start again because I knew God was calling me here, all this was new. After two long orientation weeks, I remember my first worship service. We gathered in Alumni Hall. I sat towards the back because I was shy and I did not know many people. I saw the worship team at the front, and I immediately noticed how diverse the team was. The worship leader invited people to come up to the microphone and to sing the song, "God is So Good," in their native language. I never witnessed anything like it before. Fast forward 4 years, a few weeks ago, I attended one of my last chapel services in Kaiser Chapel. Before me and around me, I heard the song, "God is So Good," sung in African languages I never knew in my life. And hearing this simple song again, I felt like I came back in full circle. I saw my 4 years in Gordon-Conwell unravel like a movie before my eyes. First year grace. I have two words associated with it: culture shock. I have two more words associated with it: the wilderness. All that was familiar was stripped away. My second year, I learned to find my voice. I heard other voices. And I planted new desires, new dreams. Then the pandemic happened. My third year, still the pandemic continues. I was brokenhearted and silenced. I went into hiding to heal, to grieve, to lament. And in the hiding, I learned to forgive and to surrender. And my fourth year, I came out of hiding. I started singing again. I forgave more. I listened more. I was part of pioneering work. And now as I graduate, I am passing on the baton. My time in seminary has reflected the seasons of New England weather. In the midst of these four turbulent years, the phrase I sang most often was, "God is good." Even in the wilderness, God is good. Even in sickness, God is good. Even in weakness, God is good. Even in brokenness, God is good. Even in the separation, God is good. And even in the isolation, God is good. Yes, in health and strength and prosperity, in death or life, God is good. And all the time, God is good. And God is good
all the time.
And so, this is my short story, my short song during my time here to testify the goodness of the Lord. And I know my story is not my own, for I had the privilege to sing this song with many of you. In fact, I believe the beauty of a song is to be able to sing with one another. Songs bring us together and remind us that we are part of something greater, bigger than us. And we may have different vocal ranges, and that's great. Some of you may not consider yourself a singer, and that's okay. I know we got some dancers in the room. You are still part of this song. Students, families, friends, staff, and faculty, all of us here are part of a greater song. Fellow classmates, what is the song you sang the most during your time in seminary? And what is the song you would like to sing in the next season? To all beloved Gordon-Conwell community, what is your next song? And I don't know what your next song will be. Maybe it will be Revelation 19, where we sing hallelujah. Salvation and glory, honor and power unto the Lamb of God. Whatever song God is teaching you, teaching us, may our songs bring glory to his name. Amen.
Good evening, President Sundquist, deans, faculty, students, family and friends. Congratulations to fellow students who are graduating here tonight. It's been quite a journey to get to this day, hasn't it? And I don't mean just traveling across the Atlantic from Northern Ireland to Boston. I mean the journey from the start of our academic studies to this point here and this evening. It's been quite a journey of learning, reading, residentials, more reading, projects, seminars, writing, even more reading, sacrifice of time, family, friends, financial commitment, prayer, preaching, more prayer, thesis writing, and oral defense. And people often ask, how did you do it? And I reply, I had help from the travel songs. Travel songs have been used by people of faith for centuries. Eugene Peterson calls them songs for the road, songs for sung by Hebrew pilgrims as they went up to Jerusalem to the great worship festivals. The journey involved a 17-mile upward hike, during which they sang the songs of ascent, likely Psalms 120 to 134, sung possibly in sequence. For example, Psalm 126, verse 3, "The Lord has done great things for us, and we are filled with joy." Friends, aren't we thankful to God today for the great things he has done for us, enabling us to complete our degrees? And aren't we just filled with joy to him as we celebrate with family and friends and faculty? And there are no better songs that are directed to God for those who travel the way of ministry and study. In fact, everyone who travels the road of faith requires help from time to time. We need encouragement when our hearts grow weary and our spirits grow heavy. And over the last 3 years, as I've studied for this Doctor of Ministry degree, while engaged in full-time mission and ministry overseas, my wife Marjorie and I often prayed, "Lord, are we there yet? How long, Lord? How far, Lord?" But what kept us going during the journey was the travel song, songs for the road, scripture that we sang and prayed and read, and others sang and prayed and read over us and to us and with us. And it's that concept of engaging with scripture that encouraged me the most through the DMIN course. The Doctor of Ministry course was soaked and saturated in scripture. I was challenged to think theologically throughout the course as we engaged with reading and teaching on pastoral care, leadership, and preaching. It was a joy and a privilege to engage globally through interaction on the cohort with students throughout the USA and from Ghana, Haiti, South Korea, South America, India. And after each residential, I was sent back equipped and encouraged to live biblically in my context of the Middle East, serving with a minority Christian community living under a dominant religion. My thesis project centered around the development of a pastoral care training manual to be used in a cross-cultural context. For me, that was an Arab congregation in the Middle East. It was a joy and a privilege to teach the content of the manual to Arab men and women engaged in pastoral care, to the congregation, and especially to refugees. And none of this would have been possible without the training and instruction I received on the Pastoral Theology and Practice DMIN course. And for that, I'm grateful to the Faculty and Administration Department, particularly to Drs. Dave Curry, Simon Viber, Phil Thorne, Kelvin Choi. And your fingerprints are all over the lives of men, women, and children throughout the Middle East and North Africa. I was in contact with people from Egypt daily, Iraq, Sudan, Syria, Jordan, Lebanon, and beyond. Only eternity will reveal the contribution that these doctors have made to the transformation of lives throughout the Middle East. Their influence has continued as I've returned home to parish ministry in February as an associate minister amongst a 3,000-strong congregation, with the DMIN course acting as wind in my sails, propelling me into the final 10 years of ministry. But let me finish by making special thanks to Marjorie, my wife and fellow worker in mission and ministry, and also finish by asking fellow students, graduates, faculty, family, and friends, are you singing the travel songs, songs for the road? If not, can I encourage you to begin now? Because combined with the training you've received at Gordon-Conwell Theological Seminary, singing the travel songs will transform your life, transform your ministry to the glory of God. Amen.
Let's give a round of applause to the Lord for this celebration today. Welcome, everybody, to the graduation of the class 2022. It is an honor and a privilege for me to be together with you to celebrate this achievement. On behalf of all the students, I want to thank our faculty, administrators, and families and friends here with us. We are very thankful for your presence. I'm glad to be back at Gordon College because it was during my time here the Lord saved me. He searched my soul for the faith to follow him. I grew up in a Catholic family in Colombia, and I am the first one saved. I am saved because someone took the time to preach the gospel to me. People took time to tell me that God loves me, that Jesus died for my sins, and that God had a purpose for my life. All I have to do was to say yes to Jesus, and I become his disciple. In Matthew 28, 19 to 20, Jesus told his disciples, "Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." God is extraordinary. When he put his eyes on us, there is no place where we can hide from his purpose. And if you don't believe me, ask Jonah. I didn't know about Gordon-Conwell Theological Seminary until I visited the church Lion of Judah, where a preacher mentioned that he was a student of the MD program at Gordon-Conwell Theological Seminary. I pray, and the Lord put seminary as a burning desire in my heart. I was a new believer with a deep passion for knowing more about God. I was obsessed with reading the Bible and trying to make sense of it. I thought, is it possible to study God? Who can study God? I kept thinking. Why do people study theology? It doesn't make sense to study God, the one who knows everything. Can we discover something with our limited minds? I had many questions, and many of them were answered through seminary. In seminary, God surprised us with blessings and beautiful people. He connects us with good people, new faces, and voices bearing precious gifts of encouragement in our journeys. Our faculty and our ministers are ministers who care for their students and the purposes of God in our lives. Teachers and mentors were always willing to build the body of Christ to see greatness in each one of us. We also connect and learn from other students engaged in ministry. Seminary shapes us from the inside out, from deep spiritual formation to effective ministries with leadership. As graduates, God invites us to be partakers of his plan for a better world, a dream that comes true today. God prepared us for the adventure by providing the supplies we needed for our ministries, a journey that is sometimes difficult but also delightful. Graduates, we are part of the Great Commission as disciples of Jesus Christ. Jesus commands us to go into the world and to make disciples. Our graduation is not the end of the journey, but it's just the beginning. Ministers and disciples of Jesus, wherever you go, whatever you do, teach the people about Jesus and be his witnesses so that many can come to the Lord. Jesus never said it will be easy, but he promised to be with us in whatever we face or go through. Thank you to the mentors, teachers, and preachers, colleagues, hosts who made us who we are, the unseen persons who have fulfilled their mission. You were there when we thought we couldn't do it. You helped us to discover we can. Thank you to the laughing, cheering, and applauding friends and families who have been solid and silent supporters in our shadow, encouraging us to go for it. Thank you, because we would have failed without you. So thank you all. Today, we all made it here because everything is possible with God. We can say we owe it all to him, and to him be the glory forever. Amen.
Paz de Cristo.
Peace of Christ be with you.
Saludamos a cada uno de ustedes en este día tan especial.
We give you Christian greetings to each one of you on this very special day.
Donde vemos concretado un sueño y anhelo que comenzó hace 4 años.
Where we see the dream fulfilled that began 4 years ago.
Y fue el haber tenido la oportunidad de estudiar junto con mis compañeros en esta maestría.
And that dream was to have the opportunity to study with my colleagues this master's degree.
Con la finalidad de poder servir más eficientemente en la obra de Dios.
With the goal of being better formed for the task of serving the Lord Jesus.
Estas palabras son a nombre de ellos en agradecimiento y primeramente dirigidas a nuestro Señor Jesucristo.
These brief words are a form of gratitude. And firstly, directed to our Lord Jesus Christ.
Quien proveyó todo y aún más de lo necesario.
Who provided all and even more abundantly than what we needed.
Para que se pudiera llevar esta maestría.
So that we could study in this master's degree.
Y estuvo en los momentos de debilidad.
Even where we have moments of weakness.
De incertidumbre.
Uncertainties.
E incluso de enfermedad.
And even being sick.
Él siempre estuvo ahí.
The Lord was always with us.
Sin duda fue un viaje lleno de conocimiento.
Without a doubt, it was a journey full of knowledge.
Y también de retos.
But also challenges.
porque hacía que nosotros mismos nos desafiáramos,
for it forced us to force ourselves,
para confiarnos después también que podíamos hacerlo.
So that we can then trust ourselves that we could, yes, reach the end.
Y seguir adelante.
And finish to the very end.
Esto nos ayudará sin duda.
Surely this will help us.
Para ser mejores hombres.
To become better men and women.
Mejores cristianos.
More faithful Christians.
Mejores hijos de Dios.
And children of God.
Gente de bien.
People that do good.
Pero lo más importante.
But the most important thing,
que la obra del Señor siga creciendo,
that the work of God continues to grow,
desarrollándose,
expanding,
estableciéndose,
being established,
y afianzándose en esta tierra,
rooted throughout the whole earth.
Para eso nos ha llamado,
for that we have been called,
para poder atender a través de los diversos ministerios,
that we may take care through the many diverse gifts,
y liderazgos que ha puesto en cada uno de nosotros,
and leadership skills that he has granted to each one of us,
las necesidades que hay en las personas,
to meet the needs of the people before us,
en la iglesia,
in the church,
en el mundo,
around the world,
que vengan y entreguen su vida a Cristo,
that they may come and know the Lord Jesus Christ.
Agradecemos al Instituto Gordon-Conwell.
We are grateful to Gordon-Conwell Theological Seminary
por abrirnos las puertas,
that it opened its door,
para acceder a esos estudios,
to make these studies accessible,
que fueron de mucha bendición,
that have been of great blessing,
junto con todo el staff de trabajo.
We are grateful to the staff of work, the working staff,
que colaboró en diversas áreas,
that in various ways collaborated in these efforts,
a los profesores y profesoras,
to the men and women who taught us,
que nos impartieron sus conocimientos,
that passed on to us their vast knowledge,
y experiencias para nutrir más estos estudios,
who shared the life experiences to enrich our studies.
Gracias a las autoridades eclesiásticas de nuestra denominación,
we are grateful to the ecclesial judicatories of our denomination,
la Asamblea Apostólica de la Fe en Cristo Jesús,
la Asamblea Apostólica de la Fe en Cristo Jesús,
presidente,
its president,
John Fortino, Obispo Educación Cristiana Internacional,
the Bishop for International Christian Education,
Guadalupe Zúñiga, por la ayuda dada al grupo de alumnos,
for the help given to the student body,
en México para lograr finalizarla,
the student body in Mexico, that they may be able to complete their studies,
a nuestro presidente de la Asamblea en México,
to the president of the assembly in Mexico,
Obispo Martín Cárdenas,
Bishop Martin Cárdenas,
por la confianza hacia el grupo conformado,
for the trust that they gave to us,
por obispos, pastores y ministros,
confirmed upon us by the bishop, pastors and other ministers,
al obispo David Martínez,
to Bishop David Martínez,
quien gestionó lo necesario para que se pudiera estudiar esta maestría,
who managed all the work necessary that we may have this master's degree,
al grupo de excelentes hermanos en México.
I am grateful to the cohort of brothers and sisters in Mexico.
Compañeros y amigos.
Colleagues and friends.
Por esos momentos que pasamos juntos.
For those long moments that we spent together.
Estudiando.
Studying.
Compartiendo alimentos.
Sharing a meal.
Viajando.
Traveling.
Riéndonos.
Laughing together.
Y en ocasiones apurados por entregar las tareas a tiempo.
And once in a while, rushing that we may finish our task.
A mi esposa Esther Páez.
To my wife Esther Páez.
Que está aquí conmigo presente.
Who is here with me today.
Quien fue y ha sido mi ayuda idónea.
Who has been and continues to be my ideal mate.
Todos los días y apoyo en esta etapa.
Every day and has always supported me even to this day.
Te amo.
I love you.
A mis hijos Areli y Daniel.
To my sons Areli and Daniel.
Sé que sus oraciones me ayudaron en todo momento.
I know that your prayers helped me in every single moment.
Los amo.
I love you.
Sin duda hay mucho más que decir.
Needless to say, there's much that can be said.
Pero esto sigue su curso.
But we go onward.
Y solo es otra etapa más en la vida de todos nosotros.
This is only one stage for the rest of our lives.
Finalizo con las últimas palabras,
I end with the last words,
que le fueron dichas al profeta Elías.
Spoken to the prophet Elijah.
Levántate.
Get up.
Come.
Eat.
Y yo le agregaría.
And I will add to you.
Y también estudia.
And study.
porque lo largo del camino te espera.
For you have a long ways ahead.
Gracias, mis estimados.
Thank you, my dear friends.
Adelante a seguir predicando.
Go forward, preaching the word.
La poderosa palabra de Dios.
The powerful word of God.
Desde los lugares donde nos ha puesto.
From right here where we're at.
El Señor les bendiga.
May the Lord bless you.
These are just four students. I'd like to have a camp or a conference and listen to all of our graduates. I'm amazed at the quality of your Thanksgiving, the way that you've integrated what you've learned, and the way that the humility is remarkable. I'm thankful to be at Gordon-Conwell and to have you represent us in the world. Thank you very much. We're now going to have an anthem sung by our chapel choir, which comes together four or five times a year. And so, and our I think our soloist is Justin, right?
Worship God with us.
Our scripture reading is from 2 Corinthians chapter 11, from verse 23 to 30. As the servant of Christ, I am a better one. I am talking like a madman, with far greater labors, far more imprisonments, with countless beatings, and often near death. 5 times I received at the hands of the Jews the 40 lashes less one. 3 times I was beaten with rods. 1 I was stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked. A night and a day I was adrift at sea on frequent journeys. In danger from rivers, in danger from robbers, danger from my own people, danger from Gentiles, danger in the city, danger in the wilderness, danger at sea, danger from false brothers. In toil and hardship, through many a sleepless night, in hunger and thirst, often without food, in cold and exposure. And apart from other things, there's the daily pressure on me of my anxiety for all the churches. Who is weak and I am not weak? Who is made to fall and I am not indignant? If I must boast, I will boast of the things that show my weakness. God bless the reading of his word.
Dr. James Singleton has been teaching here at Gordon-Conwell for 10 years, which I believe is the longest you've worked anywhere ever before. Just looking through here, he was the pastor at, youth pastor, I believe, at First Presbyterian Church in San Antonio, at Whitworth Community Church, which is where we first met, at Covenant Presbyterian Church in Austin, Texas, First Presbyterian Church, Colorado Springs, and then 10 years here. Great pastoral experience around the country. He did his undergraduate degree at Rhodes College and then an MDiv split between Gordon-Conwell and Union. And I think that has something to do with the requirements of the Presbyterian Church at that time. And then a PhD here in Boston at Boston University. And he told me today this is not his actual robe. That's right. So do you have one?
Well, we'll leave that. We'll leave that.
But I would like to make just 2 or 3 quick comments about Jim. It's one of the another sad moment that he's graduating this year. He's moving on with you folks, moving back to the West Coast. He is known for at least 3 very important characteristics. 1, he's concerned about evangelism. His doctoral dissertation was about evangelism and how we can maintain that kind of evangelistic zeal in our churches today in pastoral ministry. 2, he cares deeply about discipleship. Not that we just convert people or bring people to a point of a decision, but that people grow in Christ. And he shows that by his commitment to discipleship among students as well as in the churches. And then he's very committed to renewal in churches, to see churches renewed and pastors taken care of in churches. He works today with Leighton Ford Ministries, helping pastors in ministry today. He's also known for scaring people whenever they go around the corners. But that's another story. It has something deep to do with his psychological condition. But I count Jim as a great friend and a great supporter of the church. He's been a great model for our students. And I want to thank you, Jim, for all the work you've done for us.
Thank you for those kind words, Scott. As I look out on this congregation, I'm just aware we need to do one little thing. There is too much wood in between me and you in the back. So could you just stand up a minute, come closer? Yeah, it's time to come close. These students are alone. Come on, up, 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 up. You're way too far, way too far. Come on, come on. Fill in, fill in. The students need you right behind them for a couple of reasons, but they need you closer. Thank you, thank you. It's kind of like intermission, except you're coming forward instead of going out, but thank you, thank you. I see that hand, I see that hand. Perfect. Now they feel closer, we all feel closer. As you're coming, I simply want to say I'm deeply grateful for the reading of Grateful of that fabulous and haunting passage about suffering. I'm thankful for this invitation to speak to you who are almost graduates. Got one more day, and then you are. And I'm honored to speak for the final time to my wonderful colleagues behind me. This is a treasured group of folks. They have put up with a lot in me, and I've scared them too. Do I hear an amen? And so I'm just very grateful. And for the trustees, thank you for your shepherding, your fiduciary roles, your visioning roles. Thank you very much. Now let's be clear. This is a baccalaureate sermon. They are not normally memorable. It's just the way they are. I mean, I've been to about 20 of these, and some of my colleagues have preached, and they've really been good, but to tell you the truth, I can't remember what it was about tonight. I remember one by Haddon Robinson, and I sat way back there, and it was on ants, and I don't know what he said about ants, but the whole sermon was from Proverbs about ants. I do remember one sermon I preached in 2014, and I don't remember it because it was memorable. I remember it because I was scared to death, and fear will do all kinds of things to your memory. It will sear things in that otherwise would have gone. I preached that night with what I thought was a decent image, that of a turtle on a fence post. It was provided for us by Alan Emery, who was a longtime trustee of Gordon-Conwell. He wrote a little book by that name, and he said, if you ever see a turtle on a fence post, you know it didn't get there by itself. There were a lot of people that helped, and so I preached that night about all of you that are just real close, that you are the people who put the turtle on the fence post, and that means spouses and parents and friends and children, etc., that got you to the what I call the graduation fence post. Not a bad reminder even for this year, but the people who heard the sermon, they kind of messed up the sermon. It got to be regularly referred to me. Jim, we thank you for the sermon about the frog on the fence post. You hate to correct people's theology at that point, but a frog, you see, messes up the illustration because theoretically a frog could get up on a fence post by itself. And only a turtle could get there with a lot of help. And so I'd want to say, you know, actually it wasn't a frog. You just say thank you, finally. And then one of the dear people who is, bless her heart, an animal rights activist, kind of took me to task because I talked about a turtle being what would have been traumatized, because a turtle really doesn't want to be on a fence post, and didn't like the image because of that, and said, you know, only mean 11-year-old boys would have done that, and wondered if I had been a mean 11-year-old boy. So I decided tonight I'm not going to give you an image. I'm not going to give you a metaphor. I'm going to give you just two words from the scripture. And one of those words is surprise. Let's all say that word together. Surprise. In fact, would you turn to your neighbor and go, surprise? See, that's what I wanted to see. I love that. Ellie, thank you for doing that. That was good. Okay. Now, the other word is rejoice. And that's a delightful biblical word. So let me read one more passage, just two verses. It comes from 1 Peter chapter 12. Chapter 4, verse 12 and 13. Dear friends, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that has come upon you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice, inasmuch as you participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when his glory is revealed. Let's pray. Lord, would you open your word to us in such a way that we can understand what it is we're about to step into when we leave Gordon-Conwell as graduates. And for all of those who are watching and cheering and proud and thankful behind them tonight, we're entering the same kind of world. What is it going to be like? Help us to see, Lord. Amen. All of you have gathered from so many different places and contexts. What unites us tonight is a mutual appreciation for these almost graduates who have come from across the country, around the globe, regularly fought New England traffic to get here, or spent hours on Zoom, more hours than they ever imagined. If you were a student here the last 3 years, each of those 3 years has been impacted by COVID. These graduates have adapted to classes online, meals in isolation, and masks galore. How many masks have you gotten? I'm ready to just sort of get rid of them. I'm done with masks. Okay. It's been a tough season. And this very semester, so many have been felled again. Some are not seated around you tonight because they've got it right now. Should be noted that 3 students, all in our Latino and Global Ministries program, died of COVID. Nellie Jameson from New Jersey, Eduardo Vega from Mexico, John Newsom in Kansas. No class, no graduating class in memory has had to experience the sheer agility of this graduating class. This spring, you even had to adapt to the academic center in Hamilton on fire and unusable. And trying the turtle on the fence post one more time. There have been a lot of people here doing a lot of agility drills with you to get you to this point. A president, several deans, tech services, food services, the dean of students, the director of housing, the cleaning staff, the financial folks, and even the founder of Zoom. But the question I want to ask you is, after graduation tomorrow, is your life about to return to normal? Do you get to settle into predictable routines and return to the life of stability? Will the congregations and the ministries we now join provide us with calm after the storm? Not to mention this war in Ukraine, political anger, racial crisis, gas prices, housing inflation, and further variants of COVID. When they settle down, will they all settle down now that you're graduating? The hoped for answer is yes. Stability and calm, the real answer is surprise! So Peter writes, do not be surprised at the painful trials you are suffering. Don't be surprised. Surprises come in all kinds of ways that do not include COVID. Surprise breakups of relationships, surprise health issues, surprise bills in the mail, surprise visa denials, surprising friends who abandon you, surprise church members who decide to leave the church. But Peter is actually urging us not to be surprised by trials and sufferings. When I suffer, I'm still in surprise. Is anybody with me? I still get surprised by this. When I came to Christ 50 years ago this summer, there was a very popular Coca-Cola slogan, "Things go better with Coke." That was modified by the very first generation of Christian t-shirts. They stole the Coke logo and put on it, "Things go better with Christ." Brilliant. I want it. I want that. I came to Christ for salvation from my sin, but also because I had bad acne, no prospects for a girlfriend, and was third string in every sport. And I wanted it to get better. The acne stayed, the girlfriend situation improved slightly, but only enough for me to then get dumped, which was worse than not having one. Athletic prowess remains hidden, but it's coming. I was surprised by the Christian life not making everything better and settled. And you know, as a pastor for about 30 years, there's been suffering. I've had to manage budget cuts with dear people laid off, building projects with cost overruns that we hadn't raised the money for, divorces by key staff member, illegal behavior by my elders who went to jail, adulterous affairs by staff members, dozens of angry emails from church members reminding me that I was ruining their church. I've done funerals for suicides, murders, stillborn babies. I faced broken hearts in ministry and burned out emotions, and this included the suffering from all the stupid mistakes I made as a pastor. And my life never got anywhere near what Peter was talking about in the first century suffering of believers in Asia Minor, nor the suffering of Christians in India, China, Nepal. Part of me wants to apologize for the past 3 years of weird adjustments, but actually, it's going to be a great preparation for what's ahead. Peter is urging us not to regard it as strange when we suffer in ministry. Now, nothing in the text urges us to invent suffering or look for suffering or suffer by being obnoxious or insensitive, but ministry and life brings tons of surprising suffering. My mother had quite a series of surprises. From young adult age on, she had debilitating rheumatoid arthritis. She had 27 major surgeries on nearly every joint in her body. She had artificial hips in the first group that ever got them when they were a brand new procedure. After the birth of my two older sisters, my mother had 5 surprising miscarriages and 1 surprising stillbirth. And then with gnarled hands and painful shoulders, she gave surprising birth to me when she was 42 years old. She earned a master's degree in Christian education in 1938 when nobody did. And she was one of the most powerful Bible teachers I have ever known. She rarely missed a Sunday of teaching God's word, even with all her pain, because she delighted in helping people get to know this book. And as a teenager, I would often go to bed hearing her crying in pain at night, hoping for the morning. And I did not understand why that surprising suffering would happen to a godly person. Our dear president likes to drive home a certain mantra with us. It works well with academics. No secrets, no surprises, no subversion. I want to counter, Scott. Could we just do 2 out of 3? Because surprises are part of the ministry that we are urged not to be surprised by. But there's a second word, and that's the word rejoice. That's a verb. To choose to rejoice is not normal. Normal is whining, it's complaining, it's grumbling. Can we all kind of have a joint? That's kind of how the word for grumbling sounds in Greek. Paul said the same thing in Acts 14:22, which has not been until yesterday on a single refrigerator magnet until Esther put it on one, but we must go through many hardships to enter the kingdom of God. That's part of the word. He said that upon re-entry to a place where he had just been stoned so that he can encourage believers. Realize that rejoicing is a choice. It's not an emotion. The feeling of happiness is what comes when our team wins, when we get a raise, when we get an A on the exam. Rejoicing is different. It's found with a nevertheless in this sentence. Rejoice is the kind of decision that Habakkuk makes, though the fig tree does not bud, and there are no grapes on the vine, and though the olive crop fails, and the field produces no fruit, though there are no sheep in the pen, and no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God my Savior. How on earth do we rejoice in suffering? Well, first, spiritually and psychologically, in suffering, we have to lament. We have to grieve. The dream we had is not going to find fulfillment in the way we dreamed it. And with all the changes in ministry as you are alive now, and that will be changing as we live in an increasingly secular society, there are lots of dreams that are not going to quite happen the way we planned it. But secondly, we adjust our expectations and we remember that God's plan is better than my plan. And that's really hard for the arrogant to come to grips with. Manna and quail are okay for dinner. I didn't really like leeks and garlics anyway. I'm all right. James says, go ahead and count it all joy when you face suffering, which means he's putting it in the column of joy. Third, I can dare to rejoice because I know ministry is also going to provide some amazing events. Along with suffering, I get to see conversions I never saw coming. And they are glorious. Marriages restored, deep wounds healed, buildings dedicated, budgets that grow, people called into ministry, sometimes even late in life, like Ed Jordan. And you get to see these things and you go, wow, this is glorious material. One surprise is that there is suffering in ministry. The other surprise is the joy. I think that's why C.S. Lewis called his conversion story Surprised by Joy. See, I think Abraham understood suffering and rejoicing. Leave your land, your people, your father's house. Go to the land that I will show you. But the journey was tough. There was famine in the land that he had to go to. He was surprised by joy. A few weeks ago, I preached on Joseph. He understands suffering and rejoicing. Moses understands suffering and rejoicing. 40 years with whiny, complaining people. You would think he worked in a seminary. I mean, that's amazing. The job was surprisingly harder than what he knew. And it turned out that getting people out of Egypt was the easy part. Getting Egypt out of them was the hard part. Somebody else said that. But there was joy. We read through Hebrews 11 and you just keep seeing that pattern. And it concludes with none of them received what was promised, but they greeted it from afar. Peter got this in his early baccalaureate sermon that Jesus preached to him on the beach, which included equal parts, feed my sheep and tend my lambs. And it ended with, and somebody else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go. As I get older, I'm not excited about that one. I just don't know. And Paul, of course, might be in first place in terms of suffering. And you heard what grateful read. Worked harder, prison more frequently, flogged more severely, exposed to death again and again. 5 times, 39 lashes, 3 times beaten with rods, 1 stone, 3 times shipwrecked, a day and a night in sea, constantly on the move, danger from rivers, danger from bandits, dangers from Gentiles, in the city, in the country, at sea, false brethren, labored toil, gone without sleep, hunger and thirst without food, cold and naked, daily pressure of my concern for all the churches. And yet it's the same Paul who writes, rejoice, rejoice in the Lord always, and again, I will say, rejoice. So then the last phrase from Peter, so that you may be overjoyed at God's revelation, so that you may be overjoyed. Now see, the first one is a decision you make. I'm going to rejoice. This one is passive, and this one is subjunctive and passive, so it might happen. It may happen, but it's going to happen to you when now that joy of the Holy Spirit starts welling up. You see, Christian joy is different than a feeling. It's expressed in a feeling, but it's deeper than a feeling. It's something untouchable. It's like knowing a secret. It's a deep gladness. It's a delight. There's something about joy that is beyond the rise and fall of our fame and fortune. Joy is a reservoir in our hearts a river that never ceases to flow. It's the fruit of the reality of the Holy Spirit, and it has to do with a sure hope about a certain future upon receiving salvation. You know the whole gospel story now. You know where we're going. And that can change every day in the middle of a circumstance. It was an October Saturday afternoon, 1982, Camp Randall Stadium, Madison, Wisconsin. 60,000 people were gathered watching the Wisconsin Badgers playing the Michigan State Spartans. It was going badly for the Badgers. They would eventually lose by 35 points. What seemed odd, though, was that as the score became more and more lopsided, there were these bursts of applause and shouts of delight from Wisconsin fans. And people were going, what is going on? It was crazy. How could they cheer when their team was losing? Well, as it turned out, 70 miles away, Game 3 of the 1982 World Series was going on. The Milwaukee Brewers were beating the St. Louis Cardinals. And many of the Wisconsin fans in the stands had something that you all have never seen. It's called a portable transistor radio. And you held on to it and put a little bud in your ear, and you're watching the game, but you're listening to another story. I'm about to preach, Claude. I'm about to preach. You see, their delight was in something other than what was seen on the field, because the baseball game was very real, just not visible. On the field, one story was happening, but another story was happening in your earbud, you see. Rejoicing is like that. Something can be happening in your life, not good. But there's another story. There is another story, and that one is going to bring joy to your heart, and it comes from the reality of another world breaking in on ours. And you live in this world chasing after joy, but you live in another world where God's revelation is crashing into this world in the kingdom of God. That'll do it. My mother died in the summer of 1981 at age 66. I had just finished my first year here. She was not present 2 years later when I graduated or the month that I was ordained. And if this old turtle ever got on a fence post, she was the reason why. She powerfully loved Jesus in the midst of all kinds of suffering that finally on this earth, I can't say it squared. I wished a stadium full of people would have been converted, but we didn't. You just have to say there's another story that she was listening to and that I was listening to. She used to tell me that if we had understood scripture differently in 1938, she would have become the pastor preacher. And so to every young female graduate tonight that I've taught, part of the joy I have in seeing you is that you're carrying on a piece of my mother's dream. And as a young woman, my mother loved to dance. But with her arthritis, that was lost. But she wrote many times about how overjoyed she was going to be because she anticipated dancing before the Lord in the resurrection. You see, every night as she cried in pain, she knew there was another story going on. And she lived for Revelation 21, 3 and 4. The dwelling of God is with men, and he'll be with them, and they will be his people. And God himself will be with them and be their God. And he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, no more mourning, no more crying and pain, for the old order of things has passed away. So you will get through the suffering of this life and the suffering that goes with ministry and all of the ways it manifests itself. because you hear a different story playing in your ears. The story of the revealing of God in this world, and it's worth all the surprises and all the heartaches and all the pain, and sometimes you can't hear the story alone, and you need somebody to help you hear it. Look around you. Look at the folks on your row. Look at them. Look at them. Look at the choir. If you ever see a suffering Christian rejoicing, you know they didn't get there alone. Amen. I'm supposed to invite you to stand and let's sing to Jesus. Would you do it? Let's do it. Thank you.
Please remain standing in your pew until the students leave following the benediction. Now, may our dying Savior's love, our risen Savior's power, ascended Savior's prayer, and returning Savior's glory be with all of today's graduates, their families and friends, and Gordon-Conwell Theological Seminary's faculty, trustees, and staff, now and forevermore. Amen. Amen.